Good morning, everybody. I'm Sui Huang. I'm a faculty here and one of the organizers of this meeting. And Li Hood asked me to give you a few introductions to the phenomenon of tipping point. But first, I'd like to welcome everybody to be here and to show up, because we had a very abstract and esoteric title for this year's symposium, and we didn't know for a long time whether it would appeal to people. But I hope that in the next 2 days you will learn a lot and learn that tipping points is indeed a unifying theme for medicine and ecology. It sounds utterly broad and high level, but you will see it makes sense. So first, we were not sure what people think about tipping points, and if you are not sure, you do Google image search, and then you find that a lot of things belong to, you know, metaphorically to tipping points, and you can see there are more serious approaches to defining tipping points. So we like to be open, and although I'm sometimes pathologically purist, you know, these things might not have a lot to do with tipping points, but maybe there is at a lower level. So, but most of it today we like, or in the next 2 days, focus on a more formal and technical concept of tipping points. So, and we focus on medicine and ecology because these are the two new strategic focus areas of ISB. And one is personalized medicine, and you will hear Li talk about this in the closing keynote, and wellness, and the other is environmental sustainability. So these are our newer strategic focus, but why is that important? So why is tipping points important? And you will learn from this meeting, I hope, first in the keynote address by George Sugihara, and then in session one, which will be this morning, and part of the afternoon, and then why medicine? That's actually a new area. We are not sure whether tipping points will apply to medicine, but we have invited excellent speakers who are pioneers in applying concept of tipping points to medicine. Ecology, I think, is slightly more advanced. We have seen a couple of papers showing the proof of concept of applying tipping points to ecology. So medicine would be a session this afternoon, and then Li Hood, president of ISB, will give a closing note and give you his visions on personalized medicine and wellness. Tomorrow morning, we'll have session three that will be on ecology. Now, I'd like to tell you why the Institute of Systems Biology is interested in tipping point and state transitions. So we decided in the faculty, in many discussions, to focus on that. But ISB has a underneath that focus, we have an innovation engine which has been going on for almost 10 years, where we integrate different approaches in which biology drives technology, drives computation, and now we have a lot of data, and then back to biology. So the challenge is now how to link biology to this macroscopic phenomena of health and environment. And to give you more details, systems biology, and specifically ISB, is rooted in the genome sciences and proteomes. And then people soon realize we need to look at molecular networks through which proteins and genes interact. And now more recently, we focus on cell states, so the first level of a microscopic description. Latest technologies is single-cell measurement of cell states. Here is a cell population. Every point is a high-dimensional state of a cell. And here at ISB, there are people working on microbes, immune system, stem cells, and cancer cells. But that's not enough, because these cells are different and they interact with each other, and so it's important to also study populations of different cells that interact with each other. So the challenge is to ultimately, as Aristotle told us, understand why the whole is more than the sum of its parts. And we all agree that this is just philosophy, it's not very useful. And to be useful, you need to focus on something more concrete. And we thought these are the state transitions and a particular aspect of it, tipping points. So, and the true challenge, I think, is the mapping between the macroscopic description of things and the microscopic description, which really has driven a lot of modern biology and systems biology. So, now what is important to go from microscopic to macroscopic are interactions, especially between molecules and also between cells, and that is really the key ingredient for why you have these macroscopic state transitions. So you can see it here, interactions. If you don't have interactions, then the whole is just the sum of its parts, right? And then if you have changes here, you have smooth changes, not very interesting. But if you have interactions, then you can have sudden, abrupt changes in the quality of your system at the macroscopy level. So rather than always relying on extrapolating smooth transitions, we need to take into consideration that you can have jump-like behavior when time or some parameter changes just a little bit. So to give you a little bit more details, and that's really more for the molecular biologists, of which there are many here, they are used to think in a totally different categories, and this is more to define some terminologies to facilitate communication. So in biology, in molecular biology, we're used to think of interactions like gene A inhibits gene B, right? So that's an interaction. We also used to think in terms of causation, like a lot of gene A would inhibit gene B, or a lot of gene B would promote gene A. And as you can see here, it's becoming already complex because rabbits can correlate with foxes, but the dynamics are actually more complex and already more abstract and already at the borderline of what typically molecular biology would think of as states of systems. Here we define the state of the entire ecosystem as, for example, a ratio between foxes and rabbits. And that's already a first abstraction, so we can map a state as a point into some space of all possible states. And then every point here is a state of your system, and it changes in that the point would move along a trajectory. For example, the more rabbits you have, the more foxes you have, but at some point there's too many foxes, they eat up all the rabbits, and so on. You all know this. It's very simplified, cartoonish example. But that's not what we mean by state transitions. These are just the real-time dynamics. This is another level of more abstract transitions, and that is if those interactions would change, for example, foxes would be much more aggressive due to a mutation or so, then the whole behavior would change into a different dynamics where everything might collapse because the foxes would eat up all the rabbits and then they would die. So that's what we mean by a tipping point in a very, but I think permissively simplified manner. So a critical transition or a tipping point would be an abrupt switch of the behavior of a system between different, qualitatively different modes of behavior, typically due to a small change somewhere in a parameter of the system. So that's just to introduce terms for those who are not familiar with state space, transitions. Now, I'd like to give you one single example. That leads to concepts and contents of this meeting. So I invite you to be open-minded and think of sometimes you don't understand concepts, but you understand the contents of the talks. It turns out that these tipping point dynamics comes in many flavors. Some, for example, in terms of these bifurcation dynamics or percolations, some dynamic with spatial dimension. It can appear as network graphs or phenomenologically as, you know, these balls going from one potential world to another when the landscape changes. Some people talk about regimes, chaotic regimes or ordered regime. And I would also include analysis of very complex fluctuations to this domain of tipping points. So these are all different aspects, but I think of the same phenomenon. And then in terms of context, we have a diversity of systems to which these concepts apply and which provide a unifying theme. So now let me give you one single example from our own work. which shows some tipping point and shows you how it is important to think in terms of state transitions. So many of you who do cancer biology do this type of experiments where you inject some cells and you expect a tumor to grow, and typically, you know, you think there's exponential growth of cells, and so the more cells you inject, the more faster the tumor grows. And you can see here one example of a very aggressive lung cancer. 1 million cells, tumor grows immediately. You have 100,000 cells, it takes off slower, but then it takes off. 1,000 cells, you don't see a tumor. And I always wondered why the postdoc never showed me 10,000 cells. Just never showed me. And then one time I asked, and then I was told that it's not reproducible. And if you look at the data, it turns out, and that's work, for example, of Deepak Panigrahi, who is now faculty at Harvard Medical School, he showed that consistently, if you have a group of 10 mice, at 10,000 cells injection, half of the mice will get tumors and the other half would not. And so that's not irreproducibility, that's neat, right? That's a nice finding. It shows you that there's something going on, and without going into the details, we know now that a tumor consists of many different cells that interact. So it's like an ecological community, and you can easily model this as a tipping point, and if you are in this regime here, either you grow a tumor or you don't. So this example shows you that it's really important to grasp the qualitative ideas of state transitions and tipping points, and you don't need the math. And I hope that in this meeting, you will be inspired to think in terms of tipping points. So I think I'll stop here. I'd like to thank our sponsors for their generous support. And the main guy behind everything here is Joey Petosa. If you have questions on the logistics,